So let's put this Les Paul back together. Those new pickup rings and pickguard and stuff are really going to make it look a lot better and work a lot better. These were all cracked and busted, and the strings would probably catch in them. And because they were busted, they didn't work very good. And this is some sort of crappy replacement. Maybe it isn't, but as we've learned, Gibson, there is no vintage plastic. Let's clarify that. Vintage plastic does not exist. When Gibson built guitars, they got plastic from whoever was selling. So that's why all this shit falls apart. That's what's going on a lot with a lot of the, all the guitars that I'm seeing from the 60s, early 70s. We're beginning to see exactly how long plastic really lasts. And, 40-year mark, 30 years for the earlier stuff from the 60s. Most of it's gone. See, like these knobs here. These are, believe it or not, those are not vintage knobs. Those are movie magic knobs that I had a really talented artist replicate for me. So they look vintage. But you see, like, this sort of stuff gone. But these will last a million years because this is like bulletproof plastic. Which reminds me, I got to call the guy and say, hey, your frickin' knobs are done. All right, so let's get the pickups mounted back in this sock tucker and clean up the frets a bit. The frets are actually really in good shape. I'm just going to polish them up. There's no major dents or anything like that. And someone requested, like, I thought I hit my own head. Maybe he hit his head. Somebody requested for me to do a complete setup of a guitar. And I said, well, what kind of guitar is it? And he said, any guitar. Well, geez, guys, there's over 600 videos there. Like, dive in. If you haven't seen me set something up by now, once again, these are not how-tos. These are just me doing it. So anybody who wants to carve me on my techniques, feel free to. Because you can. Okay, let's get this thing going. I'm going to get Skycam going and go hand free. We'll call this new segment Gooch of the Week. There you go. Gooch of the Week goes to all parts because what we wanted were screws like this and screws for this. They doubled up the order on the screws like this and dicked me over on these. We've had offices looking into it. I'm not going to bitch them. I've actually hired someone to deal with this, and they're way more bitchy than me. So we had to move on and steal parts from another project in order to finish this one. Thank you. Gooch of the Week, all parts, Houston, Texas. Yep. Last call for the linseed oil. This has got to be like the topper of all questions. Like, I get asked this 1,000 times. Where do you get it? And can it be the refined or the raw? Well, you get it at a paint store. Or an art supply store. I wish some would come out of here. Raw is fine. Purified or refined is fine for these purposes. I like it in this form because it comes in a nice tiny little bottle. And shit, look, I spilled some on my brand new paper on my table. Okay, so a few drops, 6-8 drops. Then I take a paper towel and I push it all in there. This is a beautiful fretboard. Wow. We push it all in there really good. And then we wipe it off. We don't leave it on there. We're not marinating or anything like that. And what happens, this is what I was told, this is what I learned, is that you see all that gooey stuff on the bottle, it coagulates in under ultraviolet light, right? Coagulate, look that up. Sort of like conjugate, but a little different. Anyway, so what it does, it coagulates in the grain of the wood, therefore sealing out things that we don't like and keeping in the things we do like. This is, linseed oil is not a cleaner. If you want to clean the fretboard, I use the old Ronsonol. If it's really, 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 really shitty, I use Simple Green. What else should I talk about really quick? Frickin' lemon oil. That's for granny's frickin' furniture. Okay, I don't like using that. Lemon oil, pure lemon oil, is very, very, very much a degreaser. It's like this stuff. It just cleans and strips and pulls everything off. And that's not a bad thing, but it doesn't do what linseed oil does. And a lot of these products that are advertised, that, like they say with lemon oil, contains lemon oil, any sort of furniture stuff, a lot of that stuff contains kerosene. And I don't like it near lacquer. And someone else was making a remark about they hear that it lifts bindings, and also inlays, yeah. Because like I said, it has a solvent in it because it's meant to clean your furniture. It's not really meant for open grain wood. Does that make sense? You can put lemon oil on here, because that's sealed like a piece of furniture, but I don't know. And all those fancy frickin' conditioners they sell, I think they're full of shit. That's what I learned many, many, many years ago. Okay, let's get strings on this and get something going here. Let's get in a set of tens. And the old, we move this into the movie here. Squeaky clean. Dave's patented eraser to hold the stop tailpiece / string catcher / whatever the hell you want to call it. Call it the thing that you put the strings through. Okay, so I got a couple strings on it. Get these up to pitch. Don't like the way that sounds, but let's just have a look. Yeah, since it's been sitting with the no string tension down here in the lusciously humidified basement, the guitar's gotten a little fatter, hasn't it? So let's, where did I throw that wrench? Oh no, oh there it is. Special wrench. Loosen the truss rod a little bit here on this guy. See if that... Oh, look at that, eh? Just disappeared like that. That was like a half a turn. So once again, to set up a guitar, we got to make sure the neck is absolutely straight. So I got two strings hooked on it, and I got to get full string tension on this. But I think we got a good start. Someone was asking me about specs and numbers. I got to find the shitty book that I hate, that has like one or two pages in it that are actually of use, and it has a couple of numbers about how to set up your guitar, how a Gibson is set up. These are just, how shall I say it? These are just middle-of-the-road specifications, which don't necessarily reflect the professional setup that might occur depending on who's playing the guitar. Wow, is that a mouthful? That was almost like a script. So let's get the rest of the strings on it, and I'll go through the pyrameters. I'm going to try and get right in there with this. The strings breaking over here, that's why this has to come up, because they shouldn't touch here. And sometimes you got to get a magnifying glass in there to check that. But and you guys argue about yourself whether you want to wrap the strings around and are over. I'm doing it this way, and this is the way I'm doing it. But once again, just to make sure that the strings at this angle, when they come over here, don't touch this, that there's a tiny space in there. Okay, needing to set up my guitar. Tune to pitch. We got to make sure the neck is as straight as we can possibly make it. How you do that, well, that's up to you. They sell a lot of fancy tools. You can go to the Staples and get a straight edge. I just happen to have this eyeball that allows me to actually look down the neck, compare it to the string, which is stretched straight, and I can actually tell whether the neck is straight or not without a straight edge. I don't know how I've managed to accomplish that feat, but I can just do that. So let me switch a camera angle here. I'm going to do something. So stand by. So I'm looking for my special wrench here. And, oh look, the face recognition is kicking in, except it's capturing a picture of my butt. Okay, so neck must be made straight. Note to self. Get right wrench. Truss rod on this guitar works frickin' perfectly. It's not all bunched up and tight and difficult to turn. It's doing exactly what it's supposed to do. And I'm looking down that, and man, that is a straight neck. I like it. Let's continue. Okay, we're going to do intonation now. The distance from that to the 12th fret to there. We will check this again many times. But right now, I'm just going to make sure it's okay. When I look at how this is squiggled, I'm guessing it's probably pretty good. Okay, so we understand how to adjust this. Do I need to show everyone that? Well, somebody wanted to see this, so like how many turns adjusts the intonation. You measure it on the tuner, you knob gobbler. Jeez. Right, you know, we hit a note, and then it comes up E, and then we do the 12th fret. Oh, and it comes up E again, we hope. Come on, you guys got to be able to figure this out. Don't make me pull out the strobe tuner. Looking at the tuner to make sure that when I hit the 12th fret, it plays the same note in tune. You can hear the neck is so straight, the strings are buzzing when it's laying down, but we'll fix that in a minute, don't worry. So let's look at that. The G string is sharp because it's too short. The distance from here to the 12th fret is too short. So what we need to do is take the bridge saddle and pull it backwards to elongate the string. You can't do that with the string tuned up. You gotta loosen it off, yank it back, tune it up, try again. Okay, so that was pretty good. The only one that was bitchy was the G string. Okay, next on the agenda, we're going to measure the string height. Let me get the credentials. Okay, this is out of the Real Shitty Guitar Player Repair Guide. It's a piece of shit. It's nothing more than another rag by Early Wine and Stumac to try and sell their crap. You can pause on this, and in this little shitty thing, they talk about his guitar and Gibson factory specs. So when you look, you can see his guitar, everything is a lot lower. Imagine that. We're going to set this up to the Gibson factory stuff, see how it plays. And after that, if you want to jack the strings up and down, that's up to you, because it's easy. You just turn these. I'm going to set the relief. That will be adequate. It should play great. I have my own specs too, but I don't have a book or a fancy store that sells shit yet. So first thing we're going to set is this. The bass string height and the top E, treble E. And everything else has to fall in line because it's all one piece of metal, isn't it? Okay, we're going to do that, but you need the right measuring stick, now don't you? Back to joking with me about things being in 64ths. Okay, who was making that joke? Okay, so we got it all sussed in at the 12th fret, and the strings were just buzzing to high heaven. Imagine that. So, immediately, I have to start releasing the truss rod, so there's room for the strings to vibrate. Tune it back up to pitch, check this again, then we're going to get into measuring the string action here at the first fret. Once I get this set up, the next is what we call the nut action. Nut action. That sounds sort of fucking gay to me. Okay, so I got my brand new feeler gauges. And, oh, don't tell me. I took that upstairs like an arsehole. I'll be back in a minute. Okay, well, shit happened. Oh, man. I gotta get up, like, really. I gotta get up way too early tomorrow. This is no good. So where was I? We were going to, we measured the string action, we got that right, we've got the intonation set, we're going to measure the nut action, or the distance between the, let me just spin this a little bit and we can do that, distance between the string and the first fret. What did I do with that stupid book? Cripe, I closed the frickin' page, I'm an idiot. How am I ever going to remember this? I always remember this. Okay, so according to the book, where are we? 2/64 or 30 thou for the fat E, and for the treble E, 15 thou. So let's just see, 30 thou. No, that can't be right. Yeah, 30 thou. And on Buddy's, he says he likes his at 15. Let's see what if we can figure out what this is. See, that's that. And that's about 20. What's that one? 22 thou. Gotta look in the magnifier so I can see this shit. 22 thou on a fatty. So that's below spec. That's okay. And on the treble E, I'm gonna go for, what's this one, 10? Nah, can't be. There's 10. Let's try 10, see what we got over here. Whoa, she's even slinkier than 10. 9? 9 would be very low. Need the other set. got here. She's very, very low. Lower than... Seems to play. Every note seems to fret. Let's check out the old relief. Okay, the relief thing. Factory setting says 12 thou at the 7th fret. Yippee. Let's see what we got. A little bit more than 12, but that's okay. Should I attempt to drop that? Let's see what happens. So I don't know if you caught me releasing the truss rod there. Let's try doing her a little more. Well, let's see what happens. So then after, what the heck did I do here? After checking the relief and adjusting the truss rod again, now we're back to adjusting the string height. And I think I got it, but I'm going to let it sit for a day or so and make sure that I got it. So you know what I know. It's a Les Paul. Cheers, folks. I'll do another part with a demo. I got to go to bed. I'm way too... up too late, and I gotta get up way too early. Back to Movieland Wonderland. Cheers.